Hello, Pachucolandia. This is JJ Gonzalez with Al Pachuco Zoot Suits and Pachuco Lifestyles. We have some family. That's all I can say is family here to interview today. We have Julian and Lisa Mendoza, which is the main artist that Phyllis used when we started Al Pachuco Zoot Suits. We have invited them on because, to be honest, they're the integral part of the visual part of Al Pachuco Zoot Suits. So we want to welcome them. And also, as we celebrate the 42nd anniversary of Al Pachuco Zoot Suits, we want to bring on family and friends that have been there from the ground floor. So Julian and Lisa, how are you doing tonight?
Good. We're doing good, man. Thank you for having us.
All right. We're excited to have you. And I know Phyllis made it mandatory that we invite you on for an interview for this month because of our anniversary. So Julian and Lisa, give us a little background as far as your upbringing, where you grew up, and family members, and where you reside, if you want to say that, and let us know a little bit about your early background before we start with Zoot Suit.
Sure, I'll go first. I was born in El Paso, Texas, so I am Tejana, very proud of it. Border town of Juarez, and where a lot of Pachucos are, actually, even today. And I was born and raised between, or back and forth from El Paso, Texas to Los Angeles by Dodger Stadium. So I grew up in Frogtown, they called it, and El Paso. So I went to elementary school, middle school, and high school in both states.
All right.
So I was back and forth a lot. And now we live in Lomita?
Yeah. Okay. And I was pretty much born and raised on this block. Yeah. Been here my whole life in the LA Harbor area, LA Harbor, South Bay area. And I was born in this neighborhood and I've been here ever since. Still live on the same block. Mm-hmm. So my history runs kind of deep in this area. Went to school out here and this is where I live, and I still live here today.
Yeah, his childhood home is four doors down.
Yeah.
Wow, homegrown and never left. Wow, that's amazing.
Yeah.
So we're not moving.
All right. So Julian, you know, I'm new to the family, but I hear many, many stories from Phyllis about the early days of Al Pachuco Zoot Suits, and in particular, Phyllis had this dream of seeing the Zoot Suit play and starting Al Pachuco Zoot Suits. But her main thing was, how do I tie the visual into it? I'm selling Zoot Suits, but how do we get that across to the clients, the customers? And so I heard she had a call out for artists. But what is your recollection as far as meeting Phyllis and those early days?
Well, yeah, it goes back, man. Today I celebrate my 61st birthday. So I'm 61 years old today. But my journey with Phyllis and the Estrella family started when I was 18 or 19 years old. So we're talking over 40 years. We're talking about the late 70s. So it goes way back.
Wow.
I've always been into that style of clothes because of my dads and my uncles and stuff. And I was always hoping to kind of know more about that outfit, know more about that culture and everything. And it wasn't really alive in the 70s that much. You know, I was born in the 50s, came up in the 60s, and in the 70s, it wasn't that big, but I was always into it because I've always looked at vintage photographs and stuff like that. And to make a long story longer, I was looking at Lowrider magazine one day, and they just got started in 77. This is, just 78. This is right after Lowrider got started. And I saw a small ad advertising Zoot Suits or Zoot Suit pants, I think at the time, or Zoot Suits. And that was my first, as soon as I saw that, I thought, okay, because up until that point, all of us guys that wanted to dress like that, what we used to do is go to vintage clothing stores and secondhand stores, and we used to get what they called old timers. Those were big 1940s pants that were, kind of salvage from the old days. Right. And I'd go down to San Diego, all the way up to Santa Barbara, and go to these shops and get the biggest pair I could find, you know, take them into a size 27 inch waist at the time and get them pegged. And those were my drapes. Those were the closest I could come to authentic Zoot Suit drapes back then, because my dad and my uncles used to tell me what they're about. But those clothes that I used to get, they had been through a lot, man. They're a little rough around the edges. And I was always thinking, man, I would like some new ones that look like this. And then I saw that a little ad, wasn't a very big ad, like a sixth of a page. Anyway, it was good enough for me to drive to Fullerton and go investigate. Wow. And so that's what I did, man. I didn't even know where Fullerton was. I didn't get out of the neighborhood much back then, almost like now. So I didn't know anything about, you know, I was about 18 years old, right? Maybe 19 at the time, and took one of my old cars, I think, down there. It took me more than an hour to get there. But I was thinking about that today. And on the way down there, I envisioned this place. And if anybody that hasn't seen this beautiful Art Deco corner Zoot Suit store with a beautiful showroom filled with everything Zoot Suit. See, that's where I thought I was going back in 78.
Right.
You know, and in my mind, I thought I was going to pull up to that place. And it's funny because it's the way it is now is exactly the way I pictured it back in the 70s when I was driving there. And I guess you know by now, that's not what they had in the 70s. In 1978, I rolled up to the address and my hopes were kind of like, I couldn't find the place, man. It was hidden, not where it is now. It was across the street at the Orange Fair Mall. It was hidden in a strip mall. And there wasn't anything that said Zoot Suit or Al Pachuco anywhere.
Right.
And the address was to Albert's Jeweler.
Right.
So I was like, you know, I was like, man, what happened to that big giant building I had in my head at the big giant showroom? And turns out that I guess Albert, may he rest in peace, Albert came out because he saw me looking, driving by a couple of times in the parking lot. And I told him, you know, I got the address, but I'm looking for the Zoot Suit store. And he goes, oh, you found it. This is it. And, you know, anybody that was lucky enough to meet Albert knew that with his smile and with his positive energy, it was hard not to just want to talk to the guy. I was really had my heart set on getting, you know, a Zoot Suit and this and that, the other. Then all of a sudden, it was just about having a really great conversation with a man I just met. And he reminded me of my dad. He reminded me of my grandpa. And he was just really good, you know, just really good to talk to. And all he kept saying was that about every half an hour, wait till my daughter gets here. And after about an hour, I was like, man, I don't think I'm getting a suit or pants or nothing, because all I see is jewelry.
Right.
And then all of a sudden, here comes his daughter walking in, and Phyllis walks into that little jewelry store with a smile just like her dad's. And I'll never forget that. As soon as I saw her smile, I was like, I'm in the right place. And I still didn't see no suits, though. I didn't see anything, man. And so she told me what was going on, and she asked me what I was looking for. And at the time, I was just looking for pants. I used to wear overcoats a lot, so I'd wear the drapes with the overcoats. So she took me back to the corner of the back of the store, and there was a garment rack with a couple of hangers with a couple of pants on them. And that was the Zoot Suit store. And she showed me this beautiful pair of pants with gray. It was gray pinstripe. And she goes, something like, you know, is this what you're looking for? I said, that's exactly what I'm looking for. She goes, you know, let me take your measurements and I'll have them for you next week. She took my measurements and I talked to her for a while. And then the following Saturday, I went down there. She just what she promised, the exact material fit me perfect. And they were brand new. They weren't secondhand, stained and tore up. They were just really, you know, at the time, I think Edmundo Galvan was with the tailor back then. And he was a master, man. And yeah. I couldn't believe how well they fit. And they had me, man. They had me right there. And then I said, now I want one in all kinds of different colors. And at the time, she was limited on fabric, so she showed me what she had. And long story short, they started making my pants. After that, they started making my suits. And this is still in the 70s, remember?
Right.
And I remember, I'm embarrassed to say that this, you gotta remember, this is the height of the disco era. You're probably, I don't know if you're old enough to remember that, but everybody was pretty much doing three-piece polyester suits.
Right.
So when I'd be out, when I'd go out, and I was going out a lot back then in the 70s, it was rare to see somebody in a vintage-looking authentic Zoot suit. And at the time, I was getting nothing but double-breasted Zoot suits. Right. I was getting always double-breasted Zoot suits because that's what I saw my dad and my uncle and the older guys from the photographs. So they used to ask me where I got them, and I didn't want to tell them. Because there was a part of me that didn't want everybody to have them,
right.
But then I got over that, yeah. And so that's how I met Phyllis. And she just, you know, once if you know Phyllis, you know what I mean. And right. And her dad, it was just I could hardly wait to go down there. Every time I got paid, I'd go down there and try to get another pair of pants. Or and then she had hats, you know. And then little by little, she started getting more clothes, and then the rack got bigger and. Eventually outgrew that little corner of the jewelry store. So that's how I met. So like I said, that's back in 78. That's how I met Phyllis, and her kids were young at the time. Little Ray, I call him Little Ray because I met her husband, Ray, and he's always been Ray Sr. So Little Ray must have been around 4 years old when I started going over there. Wow. So and her kids were very young still. And again, I was probably 19 at the time. I thought I was grown, but looking back, I guess I was still around 19, you know, 20 at the time. But right. Yeah, that's over 40 years ago. And that's how I started going over there. Had nothing to do with business. It was all about trying to, okay. You know, to get, you know, I was getting the clothes and done.
So you were a customer first, and then that led into the artwork, right?
Yeah, I liked what they had as far as it caught my eye to go to the shop. It was a little rendering of a Zoot Suiter. So whoever did that back in the 70s, I give him a lot of credit because it caught my eye. You know, I liked the drawing. I liked it. It was enough to get me in there. But there was a part of me that thought, man, maybe one of these days I'll do one for her. And I just never said nothing. But she used to see my renderings because I used to work directly with a tailor sometimes. And I used to sketch out how I wanted my stuff. And then, I don't know, one day I know for a fact I was a commercial artist back then, do a lot of advertisement. I went to an interview out there in Fullerton and I stopped by to see her. On the way back, and we started talking, and I had my portfolio in the car with me. And up to this point, she didn't know what I did for a living. Mm-hmm. She just knew I was a Zoot Suit customer, and I got a lot of clothes made there. And then when I showed her, she asked me what I'd do one for the shop. And so that was the very first one. But that was 10 years after I'd been a customer for her.
Oh, wow.
Okay. Now we're talking to the 80s.
Right.
But, you know, probably the late 80s. The first time I did my first rendering for her, because she was already kind of established and, you know, may not had a lot of images out there, but she, you know, word of mouth or whatever. But it wasn't till about 10 years after being her customer that we started thinking about me doing artwork for her.
Right. Well, I'll,
at that time we were good friends.
Yeah. And I'll tell you what, she gives you a lot of credit for taking the business where it is now. And I just want to mention, if you look, The background we use is a store in Fullerton, corner of Rosslyn and Harbor. And if you look at the facade, all of those are Julian's artwork and that have been, you know, enlarged and put up on the roof. But yeah, she, you know, I just want to mention this story. So we had the 40th anniversary. Of course, Julian was there with Lisa. And, you know, you were like a rock star in that room, man. Everybody that was there wanted a picture with you. So I think you're very modest about, you know, you're not only important to Zoot Suit, but you're important to the whole Pachuco lifestyle because, like I said, everybody was excited that you were there. And I saw you going out there and taking pictures all night long. And so we want to say thank you for being there. But yeah, you're part of this whole culture and your artwork is amazing. And you also have it in the background there. And we were talking a little bit before about your very, I guess your first one was the Five Guys, is that correct?
Well, no, that wasn't. I did other ones for her back in the 80s. That Five Guys was probably 91, but okay. In the around 86, 87, I started doing a little bit more artwork for her to advertise in Lowrider magazine. And again, I felt honored that she let me do that and we worked together because, you know, she exposed my art to the whole country and the world, you know what I mean?
Right.
And a lot of people tell me, man, I remember when you used to have your stuff in Lowrider magazine, I correct him. I say, you know, that was Phyllis and the Zoot Suit Shop. that put that work in there. I did the artwork, but it was them that reproduced it in the magazine. We had a full page ad, and you know, we started doing you know, full page ads and posters and calendars and checks and all kinds of stuff. She would come up with ideas, and I would try to, you know, try to make it work on my end. And yeah, so I've always felt fortunate that she liked my stuff, and we worked good together. She's pretty easy to work with. It was always a pleasure. It wasn't like we were doing hardcore business. So through her, I've gotten a lot of opportunities because over the years I got a lot of exposure.
Right. Okay. So let's touch in onto your lovely wife here sitting beside you. We want to get her perspective on El Pachuco Zoot Suits. So Lisa, why don't you tell us about your experience or how you were connected to El Pachuco Zoot Suits?
Sure. I received, I don't even remember if it was MySpace back then, but I received a message from Vanessa from La Pachuca on social media asking if I would be willing to model some of her clothing from La Pachuca. And I said, yeah, of course. And I you know, I love the style, of course. And I jumped right at it. And I remember I brought my friend with me, who is Laura. Other people know her as Ruby Champagne. And we went and we tried on the clothes, and we just had a great time modeling for La Pachuca. And that's how I met Vanessa. And after that, you know, we just stayed connected and stayed friends. And it was just a wonderful opportunity, you know, because they use the images for their postcards and advertising and all these things. And it was just an honor, you know. And then meeting Phyllis and the whole family, you know, it's an honor to know them because they are such beautiful people. And so that's how I met Vanessa first.
And you and Julian met through the business, or how did you two become an item?
Who wants to tell the story?
Well, it seems like our story differs a little bit, but
we got time. We could hear both of them.
But
I'll just correct him when he's wrong.
There you go. Vanessa and fast forward to I don't know how long it's been. I think I heard Vanessa say close to 19 years she's been in the picture. You know, after the 70s and the 80s, and all of a sudden I could see that, Little Ray was, grown and carrying his weight and doing what he had to do. And then he hooks up with, and they find him and Vanessa find each other, and they just, put both of their energies together to continue this movement, because it is a movement. Yeah. Because I want to say, if it wasn't for Phyllis, what happened in the 30s and 40s probably would have just died. But I'd like to think I helped her keep the Zoot Suit and Pachucos alive for a couple more decades. Now it's strong. I don't think it's going anywhere. But it wasn't, I credit Edward Olmos and the Zoot Suit play, but Phyllis took the ball and ran with it. They did a play and they did a play, but Phyllis didn't let that die. And I think because of that, a whole two new generations know what a Zoot Suiter is, what a Pachuco is, and what difficult history that means, they went through. I think it's because of the family, the Estrella family, that history is still kept alive. But so I want to tell you, when Little Ray and Vanessa started doing a lot of shows, they used to invite me to do them, and I just wasn't doing any shows like that. I was working, I'm working full time, and they would buy my prints to sell at the shows. And I think Vanessa, she jokes around and she has a way of talking me into things. She's like, if you would come to our booth and maybe sign some prints or whatever, next thing you know, I'm doing a show with them. So I think Ink and Iron was one of the first ones I started doing with them. And they encouraged me to do, they said, your stuff's kind of popular in the tattoo shows and the rockabilly scene. And at the time, I come from more of a traditional lowrider background, and I wasn't really aware of the rockabilly scene, and it just wasn't my thing. But I didn't realize how big there's a huge crossover. It completely overlaps. And I do think that I didn't know that at the time. So I went out there, and those shows were very good energy, and it was good, visiting with them. And I ended up vending right next to them. or actually connected, they would have a certain amount of boost and I'd be on the end. And I started doing the shows and I noticed that they used the image of Lisa. They had images of Lisa, and I, you know, I'm not gonna lie, just noticed the images of Lisa, you know, the way she did her thing. And I figured, you know, she was an artist in her own right. And I saw Lisa in print before I met her in person. And then the time we really met and connected was at an Ink and Iron Festival at the Queen Mary. And she was went there to visit Ray and Vanessa. And I happened to be in the booth next to him. And I was aware of her because some of the images, that, some of the garments that she modeled were some of my images. And I think she was aware of the artist, but we'd never really met till that weekend. Uh-huh. And it was a 3-day weekend and we got a chance to sit and connect. And I think, again, if it wasn't for Vanessa and Ray and inviting me to that show, and I don't know if we would have had the opportunity to meet like we did. So that's how we met, that Ink and Iron show about a decade ago.
Right. And Lisa, you have anything to add to that story?
That's he's right. Although I think we met, before 2010.
But we never talked or nothing.
But we didn't talk. And then that weekend that he's talking about at Ink and Iron, that was 2010. And he's right. The only thing I wanted to add is I was there, you know, to enjoy Ink and Iron because I loved Ink and Iron. And I was there to, you know, photograph with some cars and, you know, meet people, see people, hang out with my friends and do all of that stuff. And
real quick, I was going to say yes. Ink and Iron, for those who don't know, it was a tattoo, car show, art festival, music, all in one 3-day weekend.
It was the Queen Mary.
Yeah, so I'm
in
sorry.
Long Beach, yeah. Amazing festival. Yeah, it's a 3-day long festival. And I went there, and when you first walked into Ink and Iron, El Pachuco Zoot Suits had just perfect placement of their booth because it was right when you walk in on the right. And so I saw Vanessa, said hello to them. And then Julian was next door to them with all of his art prints and stuff. And I had some prints and stuff that, you know, I was gonna give to people that I encountered and stuff. And I needed a place to put them down. So at the time, Vanessa had teased me, because you guys know she's great at teasing. And she teased me, she says, oh no, we don't have any room for your stuff here, right? And Mr. Shy here was like, I have some room over here on this side. And so I was like, oh, don't worry, Vanessa. Julian has some room over there. So that was kind of-
I forgot about that.
Yes, so that was kind of the first thing. And I was like, it's okay, I'm gonna put my stuff over on this guy's side, right? And to make a long story short, because it is a very long story, I sat with Julian for 3 days.
Wow.
I didn't do my shoots. I didn't hang out with my friends. I didn't give out the prints that I had lugged along with me. I didn't do any of that. I sat with him in his booth and talked to him for 3 days. And I left there feeling so grateful to have an opportunity to sit with someone who was so deep, so different, so attentive and engaging in the conversation that we were having. And we were talking about real life situations, real, you know, heartfelt things. It wasn't just, you know, like I don't know. It was just very special and very different that for the next 2 days after the first night, I couldn't wait to sit with him again. And it wasn't romantic.
Right.
It was just getting to know each other and him telling me about his journey, me sharing mine. My son was just getting ready to leave to South Dakota to the Hot Rod Institute to go to school. And it was the first time that we were not going to be together. And so I was going through kind of the empty nest preparations, and he helped me, you know, put my feelings together and figure out some things. And he helped me, you know, during those 3 days, you know, being a single mother. And it changed my life.
Right.
You know? So
amazing story, amazing love story.
I was gonna tell you, that was on June 12th, on that day that we met. Mm-hmm. And then a year to that day, June 12th, we got married.
All right. And So how many years have you been married?
9 years, together 10, but married 9.
All right.
Married right away. Well, a year after that very first day, we were married. And what was really funny, another thing I want to mention is Vanessa, she's so funny. So we're sitting there for those 3 days connecting and talking. And again, it wasn't romantic. We were just really, you know, engaged in our conversations because it was right. So interesting to get to know him as a person. And she would go with her camera and she'd pass by and just like go, you know, we were sitting back there and she would pass by and snap pictures. Yeah. And, you know, I guess she knew something was happening, you know.
She's a teaser. She used to tease me a lot because I was always alone. And she's known me for her whole life that I've known her. She's always seen me alone. So I think it was a little, she was, you know, giving me a hard time for spending so much time talking to someone because, you know, I was just a single father and, you know, that's all she's ever known me as. Mm-hmm. And so when she saw me talking to Lisa, she just kind of teased me a little bit, teasing us a little bit.
Yeah. But I'm grateful for that because those pictures are really special to me now.
Yeah. Well, being the kind of the, you know, the historical guy, I'm going to go look for those pictures now and ask her for them so we can
pick
those up.
Yes.
That's when I used to look younger, though. You won't recognize me.
Oh, we look exactly the same. Don't worry.
Okay. And now I want to go back to, because I forgot to ask this question, was Julian, now where did your passion for art come from?
I think I was the little kid that was always drawing. So I really can't remember not drawing or coloring or, you know, I was a kid in class. I used to help the teacher draw something, you know, on a zoo animal. I was always drawing, man. So I don't know where it came from. I just always remember drawing and I always remember doing some type of art.
Wow. And no formal training or?
I went to a trade school back in, I want to say 76, 77. I went to LA Trade Tech to learn the technical parts of art because even back then, everybody knew fine artists don't make a living. So I went to a technical school, but it wasn't about the paintings that I do. It was more like the technical background and it was a great help. And that's what I ended up doing for years. But I think I've always been drawing. And now that I look at my journey, because I've been through some stuff, I think if it wasn't for art, I think art helped me through a lot of stuff. Just
right.
Because no matter what I was going through, I was drawing.
Right.
And a couple of years when I was unable to, for whatever reason, I was off balance, man.
Right.
You know, I think a person, when they have that in them and they don't exercise that, it's off. So I don't know where it came from, but my mother, you know, may she rest in peace, she is very artistic and, you know, maybe it was that.
Right. It does run in the family. His mother.
And my sister.
Beautiful, beautiful oil paintings. And then his sister as well. Yes.
And I think you touch on something too about, you know, that creativity that a lot of young children, teenagers, and young adults have. And they just don't know where to find that platform. So, I mean, we always talk about budget cuts in education when it comes to arts. It is very important because it's just a release to that creativity needs to be released in a lot of our, you know, students and sometimes it does get suffocated, you know, for whatever reason. So that's a great story, Julian. And Lisa, now you have your own creativity on the other end. And once again, I'm new to the family. So I'm just going to say the stories, the things I hear, but I know for a fact, because on your Instagram page about you design clutch purses. And from what I heard, it was like Julian does not wear long sleeve. You could correct me if I'm wrong, right? So he cuts them short and then hems them, and a lot of them are Pendletons. So you take the extra fabric and make these clutch purses, and that's how I first saw what you were doing. So tell us a little bit about your business and how that started, your creativity, how it started, and how your business is going.
Okay, great. Well, I've been creative forever. like Julian says. I did want to add just one thing to that last conversation about like young artists and stuff. Since I've known Julian, there have been numerous, hundreds of young adults that come up to him and say, I started drawing with your art, you know, when they were young, you know, when they saw his paintings in Lowrider magazine, and they come up to him and say, I'm an artist because I saw your Zoot Suiters. I'm getting the goosebumps right now.
But being nice, but some of they come up to me and they're gray with a gray goatee and everything. And said, yeah, I've been drawing your art since I was a little kid. And they're in their 40s. They're in their 40s and close to 50. And I was like, wow, I get the compliment, but it kind of maybe took me back. Yeah. Some of these artists, they're in their late 40s now and doing great things. And that feels good.
Yeah, yeah. So many people have said, you know, I grew up with your art.
Right.
You know, practicing drawing the Zoot Suiters from your drawings. And so I just wanted to mention that.
But I was going to tell you real quick, the story, when we got together, we were going through the garage and cleaning some of the stuff in the garage. Yes. And there was a big plastic bin. I had a big plastic bin. And she's like, what's in here? She opened it up and they're all the rest of the Pendletons that I cut off. I saved all those sleeves because I just figured maybe, I don't know what I was going to use them for.
It's beautiful. But I had
hundreds of them in there and I just kept them for the last 40 years, you know, or maybe some of you were longer than that. And she goes, why do you save them? I said, I don't even know. And then next thing you know.
Yeah.
They were mine.
Beautiful.
And we're talking hundreds, you know. So I had, you know, this much fabric to work with.
Right.
And, you know, I just thought I'm going to make women's clutches. And the way I saw it was how wonderful it would be to match a man. You know what I mean? For your man to have his, you know, for my man to have his handsome outfit on, and then I have a matching clutch.
Right.
And so originally, just like most of my creative ideas, they're originally just for me. You know, I'm just kind of selfishly thinking what I want to use with his Pendleton scraps. And so I made myself a clutch, and then I made myself another one and another one. And then, you know, as we went to shows together, people would notice and they were like, I want one of those clutches. And so that's when I decided, I was like, okay, you know, people want these clutches. So I started putting them on Instagram and making them in batches, you know, and I just had so much fabric to work with. And I thought it was neat to be able to offer somebody, you know, a piece of the fabric that belonged to Julian that was made by me. You know, I just thought it was a great collaboration. And so in the lining of those pouches, for example, or those clutches that I made, it does have the Mendoza logo, the Lisa Love logo, and the Mendoza signature, just as, you know, a token of the, or a documentation of the collaboration, you know?
Right.
So that went really, really well. And I appreciate everyone who supported that creative venture, you know, because it went really, really well. Right. And then, you know, I've always done something. I've always sewn, I've always created, always. So that was just another creative adventure.
Right. And any new projects going on now?
Me or her?
Either one. Well, both of you. Let's start with Lisa and then we'll go into Julian.
Okay.
For me, not really. I'm just taking it easy now. You know, I feel like I went really strong during my time of modeling vintage and pinup and all of that stuff. I'm that type of person where I just have to do it fully, and I did it fully. And now I'm just really enjoying my time of aging gracefully. And being with my family and cooking and, you know, doing those types of things where modeling, I just don't really do anymore, you know, these days. I'm really proud of the work that I produced during the time that I did. And I'm good with that. You know, I'm good with what I created and what I did. And now I'm, you know, have kind of taken a shift and just, you know, really being with my family, being with my husband, and helping him, you know, with his artwork and with his website and with his orders, website orders and things like that, that, you know, Lisa Love, I feel like, is a little more in the past now. A good past, a very proud past. Yes. Yeah, so I don't do much of that anymore.
And Julian, what are you working on? And what, and also, let's not forget, before, after you finish, Julian, to give us your Instagram, information and your website, anything where people could get connected to you, maybe your email address. Okay, so Julian?
You know, I work full-time doing something else. And so I don't paint full-time. I never really have. I've always had a full-time job, and all these paintings are on, I do it on the side, and that's worked for me. Through, you know, it's been a, well, actually, when she got on board, it's been a difficult decade. The best part of the decade was the fact that I met her and married her, and she's helped me. But I went through losing my parents, went through a lot of stuff where there was years where I wasn't able to paint. Now that my parents are resting peacefully and things are different, I'm starting to paint again, because I had to put that on hold. You know, there's a lot of things I had to put on hold, and we had to take care of things, you know, that has to do with our family and her family. But I'm painting now more, and I haven't did a poster in a long time. Phyllis would know, I used to do these calendar posters.
Right.
You guys probably see, and people ask me, you still do those posters? Anyway, I'm doing a poster. I'm going to have another poster out, and I'm going to give Phyllis and Vanessa and Ray first crack at it. It's a Zoot Suit poster that I haven't had out, and I'm going to do a painting that's going to document the Zoot Suit era. So I'm going to, you know, again, I don't work full time on it, so it takes me a while, but that might be my next painting coming out.
All right. Well, we're looking forward to it.
Talk to Ray or Vanessa about it, but when it's all done, I'll probably show them first.
The sketch is beautiful. So
okay, give us your information as far as how the audience could reach you, Lisa Love, and also Julian Mendoza, your website, Instagram tag, whatever you want to give us right now.
You give mine or yours.
Okay. Well, mine is lisalove.com.
Okay.
Nice and easy. And Julian's is fleetlinefineart.com.
Okay.
Those are the websites, right?
Yes, those are the two websites. And within those websites are links to Instagram and, you know, other social media, our online store and things like that. So.
Right.
Yeah, so it's fleetlinefineart.com and lisalove.com.
Okay. And I just want to mention those calendars, Julian, are, I mean, if someone, you know, different price points, we give them out as a gift, and people really, they go crazy over them. I mean, they love them. They come back and want to buy more. And so they're still favorite of our customers when they see those. And people still want to buy. I think since I've been there, several people have bought the ones in the frames that we have posted. So there's still
from like the mid-90s, I think.
Yeah, those are the 90s. Because there was one show that I was doing at Placito Olvera. And remember, a gentleman came with his rolled up posters from the 90s. And they brought them to my show because they knew my husband was going to be there. And they wanted Julian to autograph them. And they've had these since the 90s and thought, oh, here's my opportunity, you know, to have Julian Mendoza autograph these for me. So that was really neat.
Great.
And I'm looking forward to putting this one out just because it's a painting I've had in my head and in my heart for many years. And again, if they stay in there, it throws me off. So I'm going to finish this painting up hopefully soon, and it'll probably make a poster out of it.
All right. Well, we're looking forward to it.
Just hang it up here. I don't know. But I think I'm gonna probably put a poster.
Well, we hope not. We hope you mass produce it and let's get it out there. Because, you know, your artwork is amazing. And like I said, everybody that comes in. And it's really, it's nice to see when it's first time customers come in. And, it, you know, everybody says, this is like Disneyland. You know, it's like, and they're always amazed at the artwork that we have. Because we do sell Julian's artwork. I was gonna say Lisa's, but Lisa's on some of the posters. We still have them for sale. And when we open up, hopefully, which is soon because of COVID, we're closed. But when we open up, you're still gonna be able to go and buy them at Pachuco Zoot Suits. So we still have an inventory of them. So yeah. So Well, guys, it's been great conversation, man. It's amazing your history, how you came into Al Pachuco Zoot Suits life. It's an amazing story. So